lost in. Since we have faith in Jesus today, and it's faith that brought us here this morning, we're gonna say, we love you, Lord. We worship you today. So let our worship flow in a magnificent way by singing praise and worship to God. Flow to you. some praise, y'all.
Concerned, something he wants to share. all of that with him. He said, well, okay, well, that you left or right. You left or right, so that we take that off the table. So we're just going to keep praying. And yesterday, some of you know, I've been preaching in Huntsville on and off for almost a year now at a church. And yesterday I was notified that I was unanimously selected as a senior pastor. Definitely need your prayers. Definitely need your prayers. Definitely need your prayers. Definitely need your prayers. That's all I was saying. Definitely need your prayers. And I'm confident that with the connection of this great church and this great pastor, that I will be steered in the right direction at all times. I'd like to also thank God for our very special First Lady Shug. Amen. She has loved on us and been there for my wife and been there and just been a joy to have. I'm glad that they're in our lives, but I'm also glad that you guys are in our lives. So this is not a goodbye. I'm just right up the road in the country, and don't be surprised if you see me sometimes. I'm not disconnecting myself from Good Shepherd. I'm still a member of Good Shepherd. Amen. I'll just be right up the road, and we hope to fellowship with you guys at some point. Amen? Again, I'm getting ready to go to be with the children today. This will be. They're expecting us next Sunday. I have to go go this morning because they start church late. They old school. Go today and finalize everything. But I'll be there next Sunday. I just want to let you know again that I love you. I'm praying for you, and we ask that you would pray for us. Thank you.
Amen. Mary, would you just stand where you are? Stand where you are. Father, how we love you and thank you for in your own way, according to your own power, according to your own timing. Because of Jesus, you allowed us to know the Higgins family. We recognize it had not been for Jesus, it just would not have happened. So we thank you, God, and we thank you for the contributions that they made. We thank you for Mary and her working with our young ladies in terms of praise dancers. We thank you for Phil and the area of preaching and teaching that he did while he was here. God, we thank you for what they contributed to our growth and what we contributed to their growth as a result of them being here. Now, Lord, as you take them to further areas of ministry, I pray again your blessing would be upon them and that they would know at every moment that they are blessed in you. The only thing you're asking them to do, the only thing you command them to do is to live blessed. So I pray, God, that they would live blessed. Every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places has already been supplied. Help them to live blessed. For Andre, Ashton, for Aiden, for Avery, we pray again your continued blessing on their life. Keep them, Lord, as only you can keep them. We pray again, Lord, for the Unity of Faith Church as a result of them leading, allowing you to lead them. Call Reverend Philip Higgins to be that pastor. We pray, God, that it will be a loving union as you bring pastor and people together for the purpose of glory and for growth. It's in Christ's name we ask it. Amen. And as he said, his last final act of service today here at Good Shepherd is to go teach the children. So go teach the children, brother. Amen. Would we hear from our choir? Thank you.
Someone else also. Let us pray. The one who makes a way out of no way, we call upon you this morning. How do we know you can make a way out of no way? When there was nothing there, You said, let there be. We know you can make a way out of no way. Because you spoke a word and everything came into existence. Not only did you create everything, but you keep sustaining everything every day. Because that's who you are. You're God and you're God all by yourself. We come calling upon you this morning, Father, because we need you. And we cannot make it without you. We need you to walk, we need you to talk, we need you to move, we need you to think, we need you to live. We need you in everything we do. So, Master, we pray that you would meet us where we are right now and make a way out of no way. Some of our no way is a health problem, Master. We're feeling pain in our body. But you can make a way out of no way. And we're going to trust you in that this morning, Lord. Some of us got trouble in our home. But you can make a way out of no way, Lord. And we're going to trust you in that this morning. Some of us got trouble on our mind. But you can make a way out of no way, Lord. And we're going to trust you in that this morning, Lord. Some of us got trouble on our jobs, trouble in our neighborhood, trouble everywhere we look. But we know you can make a way out of no way, Master. And we're going to trust you, Lord. The reason we can trust you, because you sent your son, Jesus Christ. And Jesus Christ laid down his life. And not only did he lay it down, but he took it up again, Master. So that shows us that you can make a way out of no way, Lord. So, Master, we come praying with some special concerns this morning. Pray for those on our prayer list this morning. You know them all name by name. You know their hearts, you know their minds. You know what they're going through right now, Master. We thank you for Brother Dave Callahan in his presence this morning. We thank you for Sister Doris Addison, Master, in her presence this morning. But then there are so many others that wish they could be here. But because of your will and your ways, they're not here this morning. But that does not mean you're not making a way in their life right now. So, Master, we pray that you will continue to meet our needs and all that we have, Master. Now, Master, we pray for Reverend Phil Higgins and his family as they're starting a new journey in you. We pray your strength in their life right now. Master, we need you this morning. We can't make it without you. We need you this morning, Lord. We can't make it without you. I said we need you this morning, Lord. We can't make it without you. So we need to hear from you this morning, Lord. Pray that you would touch our pastor this morning. That as he stand in this place this day, that you would allow him to speak your word. And we know as a result of hearing from you this day, our life is never going to be the same again. Lord, we love you. And we thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and thank God.
See Jermaine LaFleur with us here this morning. Glad to see you, buddy. Glad you're in our presence. Would you stand together as we go to the Word of God, John chapter 11. John chapter 11. This is going to be part two. We did this a couple of weeks ago, and there's still got to be a part three because there's just something about all of these verses. You just can't preach at one time. John chapter 11. Today we're going to begin at verse 17. John chapter 11, beginning at verse number 17. John chapter 11, verse 17. So when Jesus came, he found that he had already been in the tomb 4 days. Now Bethany was near Jerusalem, about 2 miles away. You know what? I don't want to assume anything. It might be some unbeliever in here. The Lord is just leading me. Let me go back to verse 1. Now a certain man was sick, Lazarus of Bethany, the town of
sister Martha. It was that Mary who anointed the Lord with fragrant oil and wiped his feet with her hair, whose brother Lazarus was sick. Therefore the sister sent to him, saying, "Lord, behold, he whom you love is sick." When Jesus heard that, he said, "This sickness is not unto death, but for the glory of God, that the Son of God may be glorified through it." Now Jesus loved Martha and her mother and her sister and Lazarus. So when he heard that he was sick, he stayed 2 more days in the place where he was. And after this, he said to the disciples, "Let us go to Judea again." The disciples said to him, "Rabbi, lately the Jews sought to stone you. Are you going there again?" Jesus answered, "Are there not 12 hours in a day? And if anyone walks in the day, he does not stumble because he sees the light of this world. But if one walks in the night, he stumbles because the light is not in him." These things he said, and after that he said to them, "Our friend Lazarus sleeps, but I go that I may wake him up." Then the disciples said, "Lord, if he sleeps, he will get well." However, Jesus spoke of his death, but they thought that he was speaking about taking rest in sleep. And Jesus said to them plainly, "Lazarus is dead, and I am glad for your sake that I was not there, that you may believe. Nevertheless, let us go to him." Then Thomas, who is called the twin, said to his fellow disciples, "Let us also go that we may die with him." So when Jesus came, he found that he was already been in the tomb 4 days. Now Bethany was near Jerusalem, about 2 miles away. And many of the Jews had joined the women around Martha and Mary to comfort them concerning their brother. Then Martha, as soon as she heard that Jesus was coming, went and met him, but Mary was sitting in the house. Now Martha said to Jesus, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But even now I know that whatever you ask of God, God will give you." Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise again." Martha said to him, "I know that he will rise again in the resurrection at the last day." Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he may die, he shall live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. Do you believe this?" And she said to him, "Yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God, who has come into the world." The subject for today, just to help us to get some under, just to guide us throughout this process, is man's extremity is God's opportunity. Man's extremity is God's opportunity. I grew up hearing this statement as something God said. Man's extremity is God's opportunity. It came from a father who said it. And so I grew up believing God said just that. Once I became a student of the Word of God as a young man, I began to search the scriptures for that verse. It didn't take long to find out that it was not in the Bible. I had a conversation with my dad who said he had heard it from someone and assume it was the Word of God. Though the Bible never said man's extremity is God's opportunity, God has shown that he used many opportunities to reveal who he was in extreme human situations. He showed it in the extreme problems of daily life. God showed Abram and Sarai that they would not conceive a child in the early stages of marriage. He waited till he was 100 and she was 90. God showed through Joseph that being rejected by his brothers was the best thing that could have ever happened to him. He was brought out of a pit. He was sold into slavery. And after spending years in prison, he became Vice Pharaoh of Egypt Incorporated. God showed Moses and Israel with an impassable water in front of them, an invincible army behind them, that he could deliver them with a stick. Once before Israel got into the wilderness, according to Exodus 17, and once while they were in the wilderness, according to Numbers chapter 20, Israel complained about being thirsty, and on both occasions, God provided water out of a rock. Did y'all hear what I said? He knows how to operate in extreme human circumstances. God showed Joshua that the impenetrable walls of Jericho would come down through marching people and trumpets who blew a priest who blew a trumpet. God would show that he could use David with one stone and a sling to kill a 9-foot-inch giant by the name of Goliath. And of course, when we come to Jesus, he made a man walk who had experienced the infirmity of paralysis for 38 years. Jesus fed 5,000 people who were hungry with 2 fish and 5 barley loaves. Jesus healed a woman who had an uncontrollable flow of blood for 12 years. Jesus gave sight to a man who was born blind. So though the Bible doesn't say man's extremity is God's opportunity, God has shown throughout history that man's extremity becomes his opportunity. He showed it in the extreme problems of death. God showed that he could use Elijah to give a widow Zarephath's son back to her after he had died, according to 1 Kings chapter 17. God used Elisha to prophesy to a Shunammite woman that she would conceive a child from an old man, and eventually that child would grow up and one day that child would die. But God would use that same prophet Elijah to put his face on that child's face, nose to nose, eyes to eyes, mouth to mouth, and that child got up and walked again. Yeah, God to show through Jesus Christ that Jesus raised a man who was dead from the city of Nain and gave him back to his mother who was a widow while they were on the way to the cemetery. Jesus raised Jairus's 12-year-old daughter, gave her back to life, who had been sick and died while it seemed he had delayed. Luke chapter 8, Jesus restored Lazarus' life after he had gotten sick and died and been in a tomb for 4 days. I'm telling you, he knows how to take opportunity in human extremity. In the case of Lazarus, though, when we look at our text today, although the Bible does not say it, God showed through Jesus that man's extremity is God's opportunity in the daily affairs of life and even in death. Unlike Jairus' daughter, he was not interrupted by a woman with an issue of blood. Unlike the widow of Nain's son, there was no intervention on his part in the funeral procession. He was on his way to the grave. But here today, we're looking at him with Lazarus. And the Bible says Lazarus has been dead 4 days. He's been dead 4 days, brothers and sisters. He's been dead 4 days. Lazarus has been dead 4 days. He was dealing with Jairus. You remember that. And the Bible says that Jairus said to him, "My daughter is sick. Would you come over and heal her?" And the Bible says that while he was yet speaking, there's a woman that came and touched him. And Jesus said that, "I literally feel the power going out of me. Somebody has touched me." And that woman was healed of a flow of blood for 12 years. And as he was healing that woman, the people from the house came back to Jairus and said, "You leave the master alone. Your daughter is dead." And all Jesus said, "Don't be afraid, only believe." He goes to the house and all he says was, "Talitha kumai, daughter, get up." And the Bible says that Jairus' daughter
got up. He was on his way. A widow is on her way to bury her son. He is literally in the coffin. The spices have already been put on him, and they're going now to put him in the tomb. But the Bible says that Jesus intervenes in that funeral procession and told that young man to get up. And he got up. Now understand, these were people that had died the same day. And Jesus now arrives on the scene and he simply speaks a word and they got up. But Lazarus has been dead 4 days. He's been dead 4 days. Could you turn to the neighbor and say, dead 4 days? Dead 4 days. It's not. He's not sleeping. He's not napping. It's not a power nap. He is dead 4 days. So now, man's extremity is God's opportunity in that. First of all, when looking at the text, he can intentionally delay results. God can intentionally delay results. Watch this. In Lazarus' case, he intentionally delayed coming when they called him, right? So now, this delay led to Lazarus being more sick, dying, and being buried. Notice what it says to us in verse 17. So when Jesus came, he found that he had already been in the tomb 4 days. Now, Bethany was near Jerusalem, about 5 miles away. And many of the Jews had joined the women around Martha and Mary to comfort them concerning their brother. Notice what this shows us. Robert Tourville says, the Jews apparently believe that the souls of a person hovered near the body for 3 days, hoping to re-enter it. Rabbis felt that after 3 days, all hope of resurrection was lost, and that only an act of God could restore his life. So Jesus understood that there was a tradition that was there that if you died, and if they buried you for 3 days, your spirit sort of stayed around hovering, for about 3 days. But after the 4th day, in the words of my elders from Louisiana, said Tufini, it was over. It was you were clinically, spiritually, for all intents and purposes, for as the Jews were concerned, you were dead. Up to 3 days, you had a chance, but after 4 days, you were absolutely dead. Jesus intentionally delayed showing up because he knew the thinking of the Jews of that time. And so that nobody else could get the glory, he delays it knowing he already knows the end result. Here's what I'm talking about, y'all. This is what Jesus says. He says, the Bible says this, that God, he's going to present to God a church without spot or wrinkle. That's the end result. In the meantime, he got to work on us. And let's just be told, some of us he got to work on just a little bit harder than others. But the reality is he already knows what the end result is going to be. And though we may not be changing like we ought to be changing, becoming all we ought to be becoming right now, there is going to come a time that he is going to present to himself a church without spot or wrinkle. Because why? He controls the end result. Not only does he control the end result, but he controls the means to get to that end result. So watch this. Jesus delays. And I would just like to imagine in my sanctified mind that he wasn't in no hurry. He chilling, man. He coming cool. He
don't notice, the Bible says that when he gets there, he doesn't rush to the tomb. Because he's just had the conversation with his disciples, right? He says, y'all, let's go wake him up. He said, well, Lord, if he sleep, the brother's okay. He said, no, he dead. But notice, he didn't get in a hurry. He didn't get in a hurry. We learned something in the class with Dr. Emil Jones a while back, 1994, 1995. We're teaching classes here at Good Shepherd Church. And he said something to us about, as ministers, he said, sometimes we want to rush to get there too fast. Sometimes you ought to just take your time. Folk who know how to lean on the Lord, they'll learn to trust in the Lord, believe in the Lord. So people are not going to be the ones that ultimately are going to give you what you need. You got to rely on the Lord. And guess what? He is never in a hurry. Can you just tell a neighbor that? He's never in a hurry. God don't rush nothing. He don't rush nothing. You in trouble? Yeah. He ain't rushing nothing. You sick? But he ain't rushing nothing. Your money is funny and your change, you know how they say it, is strange. God is not rushing nothing. How many times you've called on him because you wanted him to come right now? And how many times have you found out you can call on him like it's right now, but he still is not? Come on, help me, y'all. He is just not in no he's in no hurry because he controls the results. Is somebody getting this? I don't know. There's somebody in here that you've been praying and asking God for something. I don't know what it may be, but can I calm you down to let you know, even though he has not answered you right now, I want to let you know that God is not in a hurry. Dying and being buried. Secondly, it led Martha and Mary to being in a stage of grief. Verse 19, right? Look at verse 19. They were in a stage of grief, and many of the Jews had joined the women around Mary and Martha. Why? To comfort them concerning their brother. It took others to come there to give them comfort because they were in the stage of grief. Y'all remember those stages, right? If you don't remember, for sale, you can get one of those books on your way out. The stages of grief, again, what we talked about, the issue of denial. We talked about, again, the issue of anger, the issue of bargaining with God, the issue of eventually coming to acceptance, those five areas where we can struggle. I don't know what area that Martha
and Mary found themselves in, but they were going through that stage of grief. They were feeling bad. They were feeling sorrowful. They were sad. Why? Because Lazarus had gotten more sick. He had now died, and they had now buried him. And they didn't have to go through none of that. Had Jesus just shown up when they called? Somebody not hearing what I'm saying. I know y'all looking at me right now. Y'all saying, oh man, Mary Martha should have understood. Come on, y'all. You know, all of us have been at a stage in our life. If we be honest with ourselves, we've had some personal conversations with our Lord. Lord, if you would have been here. If you would have done something earlier, yeah, if you would have showed up when we first talked about what the situation was, when you would have showed up when we first diagnosed what the problem was, we would not find ourselves in the situation that we're in right now. Because, Lord, I already know you got the power, so won't you just go and do this thing? I know you can make a change, so won't you just do it right now? But isn't that the thing that we often pray? Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven, but make sure you do it Saturday about 3:00 in the morning. All of that could have been avoided. All of that grief, all of that sorrow, whatever anger they were experiencing, whatever denial they may have gone through, whatever bargaining they could have wanted to do with God, all of it could have been taken care of had Jesus just showed up when they thought he should have. Man's extremity becomes God's opportunity. I want to let us know, God wants us to feel the heat. Come on, help me, y'all. Come here, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. God wants you to feel the heat. He could have kept them from going into that furnace of fire, but he allowed them to go in that furnace of fire. And watch that. It was absolutely heated because the people that threw them in actually got burned up. But there's something about when God will put you in the heat that God has a way of letting you know, I got you there for a purpose. I could have kept you from going in the first place, but I want you there for a purpose. I got something bigger in mind than what you see on the surface. I got something bigger in mind than what you think ought to happen. It could have been avoided. Here's the second thing. He can intentionally delay results, but here's the other thing that God does. Notice the other thing that he does. Watch this. He can instill deeper faith. Man's extremity becomes God's opportunity, because what it does, it gives God an opportunity to instill deeper faith. Notice the conversation that goes on, picking up at verse 20. It says, then Martha, as soon as she heard that Jesus was coming, went and met him, but Mary was sitting in the house. Now Martha said to Jesus, Lord, notice her faith. If you had been here, my brother would not have died. That's an affirmative statement that she is making based upon her faith in God. Would you all agree? Watch now. So here's what it shows us. Her statement, it was based upon the most current level of her belief in him. All of us in here right now, we all trust God at a certain level. Every last one of us in here, all of our faith is not at the same level. Some are lower, some are higher, some are all the same, but every last one of us in here are not at the same level of our faith, but we are on the level of faith in terms of how much we have learned to trust God in our past. Watch this. So what happened? She believed him based upon the previous demonstrations of his power. Watch, because remember what she says, Lord, if you had been here,
That's a factual statement. She, my brother would not have died. Notice what she said. Notice. Martha didn't say, had you been here, maybe he wouldn't have died, Lord. That's not what she said. Lord, had you been here, you know, maybe he would have gotten better. No. What did she say? If you had been here, he would not have died. How does she know that? She heard about Jairus' daughter. In other words, when he was there with Jairus and his daughter, and he went in that upper room and said to her, Talitha Kumai, which to means again, daughter, get up. When she heard that had happened with Jairus' daughter, and she thought about the story or the narrative of Jesus, she knew that Jesus was right there when Jairus' daughter got up. She heard about him on the way to the cemetery, and he met the folk at the gate and said to that widow's son, get up out of that coffin. And the man got up. She heard about that. So in her mind, she's thinking, Lord, had we had the same circumstances, the same situation, the same everything go like it did for Jairus and for the widow at Nain, had the same thing happen, my brother would not have died. She'd heard about the man that had been sick for 38 years, and Jesus gave him the ability to walk. She possibly heard that Peter's mother-in-law was sick and Jesus just spoke to her and she got up. She possibly heard that the nobleman's son that had a long distance thing, that he had you just been here, my brother would not have died. Because my level of faith where I am right now says to me, I know what you can do. But I need it. Those circumstances, here's what I'm trying to help you to understand too, what this lesson teaches us. Don't try to compare what God does for others, what God will do with you. Can I get a witness in here? In other words, there are certain things that the Lord has only done one time, and he don't have to do it again. Here's what I say. Just because he did it once, prove he got the power to do it. And if he don't do it again, you can't say he ain't got the power to do it. He's already proven he can. It's just that he don't have to keep doing it over and over and over again to prove he got the power. So here's what you can't do. You can't live on your street and talk up and think about folk on the other street and make a determination that, Lord, since you bless them folk on the other street and you bless them folk on the other side of Houston, and since I know you got that kind of power, Lord, I'm asking you to do the same thing for me. I guarantee you that is not the way that our Father operates, because whatever your situation is, it's your situation, and he got enough power to handle every situation, and every situation can be different, but the same power can handle every situation. So Lord, had you been here, based on her level of faith. Yeah, I mean, sometime again, how many in our own experience, you know, had this happen? Boy, we could have just done this. Man, if we could have just done that. Man, if we could have showed up at a certain time. Man, if I'd have just had 10 more dollars. Come on, help me, y'all. Boy, oh my goodness. Oh, Lord, if I'd have come a week early, I heard that doctor just retired. Are y'all getting what I'm saying? If it had been, we got a certain level of faith. Now watch this. It is a faith that says we believe in God. But it is a faith that's trying to control the circumstances of our belief. Here's what I mean by that. God don't have to have perfect circumstances to change our situation. Mm-mm. And watch this. He is so smart that he don't need repeated circumstances for him to know what to do. Oh, y'all, ooh, thank you, Lord. He does not need, watch this. In other words, I say it this way. God don't need the same thing to happen to Tony, same thing to happen to Tyrone, same thing to happen to Anthony, same thing happened to Larry, that when it happens to Rogers, he know how to do it. Why? Because he did it for Larry, did it for Anthony, did it for Tyrone, did it for Tony. God can have new situations come up that are totally rare to Rodgers' situation. He don't have to compare what he did for Tony, Tyrone, Anthony, or Larry. All he's saying, I got the power, and now I need to take you to another level of faith. Notice what happens. Notice what happens. Notice what happens. Here's what I'm saying. She knew that there was the widow's son, and she knew about Jairus' daughter. So what I'm saying to you, don't ever forget what the Lord has already done. Just heard sad news just the other day of someone that was reporting, a pastor, and it really happens, y'all don't hear that much, but a pastor who committed suicide, a pastor who loves God, loves the word of God, teaches the word of God, preaches the word of God, but he committed suicide. Listen, what I'm trying to tell you, doesn't matter how bad your situation is today, don't forget what the Lord has already done. In other words, sometimes we get spiritual amnesia that we've forgotten what he's already done, that when we get to this situation, sometimes we can holler, scream, and cry as though he's not done anything. What I'm trying to tell you, if he had the power to do it then, he still got the power. Can I get somebody to help me? All I'm trying to tell you, don't forget what the Lord has already done for you. And don't ever think some kind of way you all of a sudden, this is it, Lord. This is it. I got the big one. I finally got the problem. Can't nobody handle it. This is it, Lord. This is it. Ain't no need me talking to no pastor. Ain't no need me talking to no deacons. I don't need to read no Bible. I don't need no prayer meeting. I don't need no intervention from my friends, because this is the big one. God is saying, don't you forget what I've already done. So watch now. Notice what happens. She believed in his reliance on God. Notice what she says. And I'm about done. Notice what she says. Martha, as soon as she heard that Jesus was coming, verse 20, Mary was sitting in the house. Now Martha said to Jesus, Lord, if you've been here, my brother would not have died, right? But she's showing she's relying on the power, right? Even now I know that whatever you ask of God, God will give you. Now watch now. Keep in mind, Martha is a Jew who is controlled by what she heard about 3 days, 4 days. She says in verse 23, Jesus said to her, oh Lord, your brother will rise again. Well, yes, remember, based upon her level of faith, she gave the right response. Watch this. There are certain things you don't know about what the Lord can do until he does it, right? Watch now. Her response is absolutely the right response. Notice what she says. Verse 24. Martha says what? I know that he will rise again in the resurrection at the last day. So what that is telling me? That is telling me that Martha is a woman who is operating according to what the scripture says, based upon her level of belief in God, and all she is doing now is exercising her level of faith. I know. Now my hope is that those of us that are believers in here today, man, that we would know that there is a resurrection for us. Can I get a witness in here? And when we live with the hope of resurrection, life has a way of being much more manageable. Because you have the hope that it's going to be better. It's tough right now. It's rough right now. But I live with the hope that it's going to be better. Now watch this. I'm not talking about just in the issue of people dying. I'm talking about with the hope that every day that I wake up, something is going to be better. Come on, help me, y'all. And watch this. If I'm not better physically, I'm better spiritually. If I'm not better emotionally, I'm better spiritually. If I'm not better financially, I'm better spiritually. If I'm not better relationally, relationally, I'm better spiritually. Because well, guess what? It can't get better than spiritual. Watch me. Here's what I mean by that. When I have faith in God and hope in God, it does not matter how bad things are on the outside. What I recognize that there are times I may have to lose things on the outside of me, but I'm gaining stuff on the inside of me that gives me a greater hope that he can do exactly what he's saying. Can I get a witness in here? He may not always change my situation, but he know how to change me fall. That's what I love about him. He don't always make it right the way I think it is, but in my mind, I got this hope that's in me. So Martha's saying, oh yeah, I know he gonna rise. Where did she get that from? Daniel chapter 12. Daniel chapter 12, she got that in Daniel chapter 12. She understood, based upon what scripture said, that there was going to be a resurrection of the dead. So all she is doing is remembering the Bible study that she had with Jesus. Can I say it that way? Don't forget your last Bible study. Don't forget the last sermon you heard. Don't worry about the next one. Don't forget the last one that you heard, because it's the last one that you heard that's going to help you for right now. You don't know if you're going to hear another one on Sunday, but you know you heard one last Sunday. You read the word during the week, and so now you got a hope that the same God that could handle the crazy folk that were doing what they were want in their own mind in the book of Judges, you got a mind that the same God that could deliver them is the same God that can deliver you. But you got to remember your last Bible study. They had a Bible study. At some point she recognized there is going to be a resurrection from the dead. So now Daniel chapter 12, look at verse 2 and 3 if you will there. You don't have to turn to it, but just remind it. She heard what he presently said. Verse 25, this was the fifth of the seven I am statements of Jesus. Jesus declared resurrection to be a person, not a thing. Notice the language. I am. Verse 25. Not it is. I am the resurrection. I am the resurrection. Watch this. And the life. Resurrection was identical to him. In other words, if you believe in the resurrection, it constituted you had to also had to believe in him. Watch this. You remember there were two groups of folk that fought against Jesus, right? And it was the Pharisees and another group called the Sadducees. And the Bible, and according to many, they didn't believe in the resurrection, so they were sad, you see. Oh, I thought that was a good joke. Everybody was on that. They didn't believe in the resurrection, so what that meant, the reason they didn't believe in the resurrection is because they didn't believe in Jesus. The only way you can believe that you're going to get up again, you got to believe in the one who said he's going to get you up. So the resurrection is not a thing. Resurrection is a person. I am the resurrection and the life. Watch this. Since he was before everything and everything was made by him, it also included resurrection in God's eternal plan. Resurrection, or the word anastasis, everybody say anastasis. Anastasis means to come back to life after having once died. That's resurrection. Now watch this. Of equal importance, Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. The word life is the word zoe. Everybody say zoe. Which means existence, it means to be alive, or it means to live. To live. In John 1, verse 4, Jesus says in him, the Bible says, in him was life. In Acts 3:15, it says, he is the Prince of Life. Colossians 3:3 says, our life is hidden with Christ in God. John 14:6, Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. So it means that life originates, functions, and holds together what? In the person of Jesus Christ. But since death is a reality attached to life, because he is life, which means that he is all life, he also is the future life that deprives death of its power. Oh! He is the future life that deprives death of his power. Watch this, watch this. He has made death so powerless that he can call it sleep. Come back up to look at verse 11. Go back up to verse 10 and 11. Look at verse 11. These things he said, after that he said to them, our friend Lazarus sleeps, but I go that I may wake him up, right? Look at verse 14. Then Jesus said to them plainly, Lazarus is dead. So what it says, I am so life that even though you die, I am so life that I can get you up like you never die. Did y'all hear what I said? I'm so the resurrection and life that even if you die, I'll get you up like you never died. Watch this. This is what this sounds like. This is what it sounds like to me. Because in my small mind, I'm trying to understand. So, okay, Lord, what you mean? What? Death is so powerless. Again, resurrection is so powerful that it deprives death of its power. Here's what I thought about. Y'all know the spring is coming, right? And when the spring comes, you know, we get them wasps and those hornets. And I thought about that. I said, you know what that's like? That's like seeing a wasp with a stinger. No, a bunch of wasps with stingers. And I see them coming after me, and they touch me. I know the stinger is there. I got all the evidence that the stinger ought to hurt me. But some way, somehow, I don't even feel the stinger. Because that which is designed to hurt me is so powerless as it relates to Christ that it can't do nothing to me. Let me see. Help me, Lord. Help me unpack it just a little bit. It's like me going to your house with that dog that y'all say won't bite. And I see that dog got teeth. And I hear that dog barking. And I hear that dog growling. But then that dog that y'all love so much, that y'all told me won't bite me, now decides to charge at me. I see that joker teeth marks in my leg, but somewhere, somehow, I am not feeling the pain. It's like somebody got a gun pointed at me. Pull the trigger. I hear the sound of the gun. I even feel the bullet going in. But some way, somehow, I ain't got no pain. That's what I'm trying to get you to understand. He takes the power out of death. That when he gets you up, it's just as if you had never died. Jesus says, the resurrection and the life. Watch this. I'm about done. Watch this. In other words, when life can be relived, he's the only one that can supply that life, but we got to believe. In other words, since God has supplied a life redo, Jesus is that life, but we must believe. In other words, since God has determined we can live again, Jesus is that life that we must believe in. Because resurrection is not a thing. Resurrection is a person. I am. opportunity, if man's extremity is God's opportunity, because what we say, he can delay the results. Oh yeah, he can help to instill deeper faith. But here's the final thing. He can inspire divine understanding. Oh yeah. We can be some extreme situations. But I tell you, the Lord can use those situations to help us to see him for who he truly is. Notice what Jesus says. I'm done in verse 26. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. Wait a minute, Lord, what do you mean shall never die? Remember what I said, I am resurrection and I am life. That even if you die, I got the power to raise you up, right? So Martha says, he asked her the question, do you believe this? And I need to canvas the building for just a little while. Do you believe that Jesus is the resurrection? Yeah. Do you live with the hope that even in this age and stage of life, you can and may experience death? Well, what that means is that God is allowing a separation. Yes, because if we all live long enough, there's the possibility, yes, that can be an obituary for us. Yes, that says, yeah, you remember how she used to do, how she used to walk, how she used to talk, but now he's no longer with us. But oh, because we believe that Jesus is resurrection. Notice what I say, not a thing, but a person. And because we believe in the person of Jesus Christ, we believe that one day she or he is going to get up again. I was hoping there'd be a whole lot of shout going on right now, because just like Martha and Mary had to cry, every now and then the Lord allows tears to come to eyes. But I got some good news for her. Jesus is the resurrection and he is the life. Notice what she said. I believe. Yes, Lord. When you say he's Lord, that means he's the master, that means he's the ruler, that means he is sovereign. Yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Christ. When you say he's the Christ, that says you believe he is the Messiah, he is a miracle worker. You say he's the Son of God. You say you believe he was manifested in the flesh. Yes, he was. So I gotta ask you, do you believe that he is Lord? Do you believe he is the Messiah? When I say he's the Messiah, he's the one that died on a Friday evening, buried in a grave on a Friday evening. But y'all know what happened early Sunday morning. He got up with all power. not matter how bad your situation is. Y'all know what happened when he went to the grave. Lazarus got up, walking out of the grave, coming out of the grave. Lazarus got up, and y'all know that's all right for Lazarus. But here's the reality. Lazarus had to die again, but I'm looking forward to the day I don't come out like Lazarus, but we come out like Jesus. He died, but early Sunday morning, he got up with all power, with all power, with all power, with all power. It can't get worse than a sick, dying, buried Lazarus. Somebody didn't hear me. And when he got Lazarus up, he wasn't sick. He wasn't dying. And he didn't need to be buried. So no matter what your problem is, and I know y'all got some people, situations, circumstances, I know you got them. But if it's not worse than a sick, dead, buried Lazarus, you gotta believe. You gotta believe, y'all. Come on, y'all. You gotta believe. You gotta believe that he's got the power. I'ma say it again. He may not change your situation, but he sure can change you for your situation. Won't you praise him today? Won't you give him honor? Won't you give him glory? No matter what, no matter what, doesn't matter how extreme it is for me. It's a cool, calm, chilly, I can handle it opportunity for God. Amen. 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 Got some testimonies in this building right now. Somebody would have told you some things you went through 10 years ago, you'd have gone through it. You say, man, I just don't know how I would have made it, but you're convinced now. Because God has taken you to a deep level of faith. So it doesn't matter what's going on today. You got hope of a better tomorrow. You got hope of a better after a while. Is there some things that God has not yet changed? Is there some things he's going to allow us to go through? But the good news is his power overrides all of the circumstances, all of the situations of life that you and I can ever face. Father, how we love you and thank you for Jesus Christ and the resurrection. Not the thing, but the person. I am the resurrection. I am the resurrection. I am the person. I am the person that people must believe in order to experience the hope of resurrection. And to that end, we say thank you. To that end, we give you the honor, the glory, and the praise. God, there's somebody in here today who is in an extreme situation. And it's the extreme situation of unbelief. Somebody walked in without a belief in Jesus Christ, but now through this sermon, Lord, that they have heard that there is no greater power than the power that you've given the Lord Jesus Christ. So, Father, help us to exercise. Help us to be in touch. Help us to trust, rely upon, depend on that power. We ask it in Jesus' name and for his sake.
Amen. Brothers, if you have one of those of you that can come, if you can come comfortably, if you will. Listen. Lord, just help me to see this. You know, when you think about human experience, the most extreme experience any of us have ever been in was that there was a time we didn't believe in Jesus. Can I get a witness in here? That's extreme. That's worst case scenario. But now you are believing in Jesus. And wow, you believe because of what Jesus has done in your heart, what Jesus has done in your mind, what Jesus has done in your soul. Your extreme sinful situation, my extreme sinful situation, was an opportunity for God to show that it doesn't matter how lost we are, He has the power to save. You heard what Stephon said in the devotion. Doesn't matter what we've done, how bad we've been. Doesn't matter how extremely evil we could have been. He has the power to save us. Y'all, that's good news. That's good news. So if there's someone in here today who hasn't trusted in Jesus as your Savior, here is your moment, here is your minute, here is your opportunity to trust Him. Here is your opportunity. Change the course of your life. Here it is. This is it. This is the moment. This is why He came. This is primarily why He came. He came that you might have life, but that you might have life not in a thing, but in the person of Jesus Christ. If you're here today, stand where you are or come if you choose. Stand where you are, come if you choose. Either one really doesn't matter. All we want you to do is make a decision today. Make a decision. You're in an extreme situation. Here is God's opportunity to turn your life around. But you got to believe that Jesus died. You got to believe that He was buried in a grave. And you got to believe that God raised Him from the dead. And if you believe that, the Bible says you can be, you shall be saved. That's good news. That's good news. So again, no matter where you are, no matter what stage of life you're in, here it is. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, so that you might be saved. Maybe today you are a believer, but you also recognize the need to be a part of a church. We would love you to be part of our church family. If God is leading you to be a part of the member, the Good Shepherd family, come on, stand where you are, come if you choose. We want you to know we serve a perfect God who's given us a perfect plan for life. And all we've got to do is rely on Him, trust Him, exactly what He says He can do. Amen, amen, amen. Father, how we love You again, and thank You for this expression of worship today in every song, every prayer, reading of Scripture, just being able to smile at one another, to shake each other's hands, sit next to one another. Thank You for this opportunity to be able to share with somebody that it doesn't matter how extreme my situation is, we got a God who is cool, calm, and collected, who uses it as an opportunity to bring glory and honor to Himself. For that, we say thank You in Jesus' name, and all who agree said amen. 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 God bless you. Won't you give Jesus, the one we love so much, give the Lord a hand of praise for His goodness and His kindness. I want to recognize those of you that may be visiting with us, if your presence here today, if you would like to stay. We certainly want to acknowledge Your presence if you are here, if you are visiting with us today. Amen, 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 amen. Listen, bro, on behalf of the Good Shepherd family, thank you for visiting with us today. Data shows that there are like 4,000 churches in the city. You had 3,999 to pick from, but you came here. So we are definitely grateful to you for being with us here today. God bless you, man. Thanks for coming. Anytime you want to come again, please do so. Amen. Amen. It's offering time. It's offering time. Come on. Just a little bit better than that. It's offering time. It's offering time. It's offering time. It is more blessed to give than it is to receive. God, thank You now for every gift. Thank You for every giver. We pray that it will be used for the ongoing of Your kingdom, the magnifying of Your name, and for the edifying of Your church. It's a
Christ's name we pray. And all who agree said, amen. 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 Would you now turn your attentions also to our monitors, either one that you would be privy to look at. We also have announcements for the week for you and I. Thank you.
Good morning, Good Shepherd. These are your announcements for the week of March 17, 2019. On Tuesday, all women are asked to attend the Sister Love meeting at 7 p.m. Likewise, all men are asked to attend the MOC meeting on Wednesday. Fearless Girls of God will be meeting next Sunday, March 24th. Fearless wants girls between the ages of 13 through 18 to know who they are in Christ and walk in this belief. Parents, please, please, please plan to allow your daughters to stay right after Sunday school on next Sunday. On Wednesday, March 27th, we will have our first installment of Worship in the Word with guest pastor Carl Fontenot of Beaumont, Texas. Please plan to join us at 7 p.m. The Silver Saints will be going to Bluebell Ice Cream Factory in Brenham, Texas on Thursday, March 28th. There is no cost, but you can bring change to purchase ice cream. The bus will leave promptly at 8:30 a.m. from the church campus. Please sign up in the lobby if you are planning to attend. The deadline to sign up is next Sunday, March 24th. At least 20 people are needed to be taken by bus. Please see Diana Johnson for any questions. On Sunday, March 31st, the youth ages 13 through 18 will be going to the Houston Grand Prix following Sunday school. Please sign up in the lobby if you are planning to attend. You can see Stefan Skinner for details. Marriage ministry meeting will be this Friday, March 22nd at 7:30 p.m. Hey, married couples, we really want all of you to attend this meeting. We have lots of fun and we can all learn something from one another. Can we count on you and your spouse to be a part too? Please call the church office by Thursday to let us know you and your spouse will attend. We are in need of youth, young adults, or anyone interested in serving as an audio, video, or computer technician to help serve in our media ministry. If you are interested, please call the church office or see Julia Johnson. Our prayer time conference call is tomorrow night at 7 o'clock p.m. Please dial in and be a part of our corporate prayer. Remember to read your program and turn in your announcements to the church office no later than 12 noon on Wednesdays. Have a great week as we press on to our 60th church anniversary, loving and exalting the Good Shepherd. And this is Casey Haywood with your weekly announcements.
Thank you. Thank you, Casey. Right on the heels of what she said on the prayer conference, I do want to say something just a little bit about that. One of the things that we're mandated to do as a corporate body, according to 1 Timothy chapter 2, we're to pray. We're to pray corporately together as a church. Listen, it's clear that many of you cannot or just not able to come or do not come to our Wednesday meetings where we do have a time of intercession. But I would venture to say, I know most of us got telephones. Most of us got the ability to dial a number. So I'm asking us, if there's no other time that you participate in the prayer time, it ought to be on that Wednesday before that Monday before the fourth Sunday. Just call it in, putting in the code, and you can mute your phone as soon as you come in. I do want to say this too, for those of you who call in, before you start talking, listen to if anybody's talking first. If you hear somebody talking, don't talk. Don't talk. Listen, I promise you, God knows your own. And if I want to know your own, I can find out that you're own. So when you come on, pause a bit, hesitate a while. And then if you hear somebody talking, just don't say nothing. Mute your phone, because some of you have interrupted prayers wanting us to know that you are on. God knows your own, and that's the main thing. Amen? So please keep that in mind when you call in. Also, right after that conference call tomorrow night, I'm going to ask, this is again for Carol LaFleur, for Shamika, Cynthia Freeman, for Monique, Lena Chantel, Camille, Patsy, and Pamela. Those of you who have daughters, part of the Fearless Girls, right after we get through with the conference call, the prayer
this again, a conversation we want to have with you all. I love the ministry, love what the ministry is about. Just want to share some things with you all about that. Thank you. Just to say a big thank you for everything. Thank you for your prayers and your encouragement, Kenneth Roberson and his family. And also, you are truly special. Thanks again. Thank you for your prayers. Always appreciate it. Again, seeing Roberson in her recovery from her knee surgery. You know, one of the wonderful things that is happening now, and I just found out about this, both Yancine and Sister Leonard, their knee surgeries. Did you have a knee replacement too, Yancine? Both of their knee surgeries replacements were done robotically. Isn't that something? Boy, man, it's so, Rev Wilson would say, smart, smart, smart. I tell you, that is smart that they're doing those kinds of surgeries robotically, which means they're going straight to the problem. A robot can't, I mean, it's laser focused. They get straight to the problem, you know. So that is amazing what God is allowing us. You'd say the knowledge that God is allowing man to attain. Here go our birthdays. One clap. Geneva Corbett, Avery Higgins, Connie Smith, Trinity Taylor, Terrence Bradshaw, Marisha Johnson, Mason Savannah Piper. Come on, let's give them a hand of appreciation. Mason Savannah, happy birthday to you. Wedding anniversaries on this coming Wednesday. Lawrence and Diana Johnson, 48 years. Wow. Eric and Rosalind LaFleur, 21 years. Kellen and Shemette Harris, 6 years. Amen. God bless each and every one of you. Amen, amen, amen. Any other announcements we need to make, Pastor? Oh, I tell you. What is John 11? Oh, Lord. I knew you had a lot to say, so I tried to write my sermon today, but the Lord kept adding stuff. Good gracious. Is that powerful or what, y'all? That's the greatest hope that you and I can have. I mean, that was a bad situation for Lazarus. You know, and when we stand again, I want y'all to think about this, what that body had to be like after 4 days. Does he have power or what? Imagine what that body could have been like after 4 days. But the Bible says when he comes out, gotta say, loose him and let him go. That's powerful. Our Lord is a power. He is powerful. And so we trust him, put all of our confidence and our faith in him. Father, how we love you again and thank you for Jesus. Thank you again for allowing us to come together from the south, the east, the west, and the north, and allowing us to bring worship in our hearts, that we were able to praise you with our hands, with our feet, with our mouths, with our minds. And we pray, God, that you accepted our service of worship on this day. Thank you, God, for the choir. We thank you for the band, the musicians, Lord, and the contributions that they made to worship today. We thank you for the media ministry, for the songs projected on the screen. Again, thank you for using Patrice. Thank you for using Zach. Thank you for using Paul and allowing us again not only to have what we had today, but to preserve for future generations the way we praise you and worship you and give you honor. We pray, God, that you would help us to know that man's extremity is still God's opportunity. We don't see that verse in the scripture, but you've shown it to us. And that's the kind of power you have. So as we leave with that in mind. To the end that our life brings glory and praise and honor to you, we pray it all in Christ's name and for his sake. Amen. Sunday school will begin at 11:10, and then we will exit at 12 today. Amen. God bless you. Until we meet again, you all excuse. Women, don't forget Tuesday night. Brothers, don't forget Wednesday night. We look forward to seeing everybody again. God bless you. You're excused.